After weeks of testing, the doctors finally knew what was going on. Now the surgeons prepared to remove the hairy brain from her hips. Oh, hey, Clemens here. I was just going through the script of this video. When was the last time you've had a headache? Maybe last month or last week or even today? Every day, roughly 15.8% of people have a headache. There might be different reasons why we have a headache. We might be stressed, have the flu, or simply drank too much alcohol the night before. But there might also be other reasons. For example, having a hairy brain growing in your body. Teratoma is a rare form of cancer that roughly occurs in 10,000 people worldwide every year. The name teratoma derives from the Greek word teras, or monster, and the suffix oma, which means tumor. Monstrous tumor. Curious name, right? The reason why teratoma is called teratoma is that it often contains different structures such as teeth, bones, or brain tissue. And don't Google it in case you do not want to be traumatized. Instead, I can draw it for you. Yeah, disgusting. Compared to all other forms of tumors where often only one cell type behaves abnormally, teratomas contain many different cell types where they shouldn't belong. So, how do they arise? Teratomas are the result of a mistake in our development. When an egg cell becomes fertilized, it slowly develops into an embryo. In this period, we find so-called pluripotent stem cells. Pluripotent stem cells can make more and more stem cells, helping the embryo to grow. They can further also become all kinds of cell types we find in the body. Brain cells, muscle cells, immune cells, you name it. And this is why we call them pluripotent. They can give rise to nearly all cell types we find in the body. And we find these stem cells only early in development. Stem cells later in life, which we find in the adult body and we have covered them in the past, only can make a subset of different cell types. So while blood-forming stem cells in our bone marrow can only make the components of our blood, pluripotent stem cells can make nearly every cell type we find in the body. Embryonic stem cells normally work very well, otherwise we wouldn't be here and we wouldn't all look similar. But sometimes stuff can go wrong.
Primordial germ cells
are cells in our early development which can make egg cells or sperm.
Primordial germ cells have to migrate to a very specific location in the embryo.
If that works, everything is normal. But if these cells do not migrate to the right location, they might escalate and make all kinds of different cells. And this is how scientists believe many teratomas arise. Teratoma can theoretically occur everywhere in the body, but they are mostly found in the ovaries, the testes, the tongue, the neck, or even the brain. Teratoma mostly is discovered during infancy or childhood, but sometimes they remain undetected for years. Take the case of a young woman, let's call her CT. CT is a woman who likes to do all kinds of different activities. One day though, she awoke with a headache. She didn't think too much of it, as she often suffered from migraines. But there was something odd this time. One side of her brain felt numb. When her conditions didn't improve over the following days, she went to the hospital. The doctors prescribed her some medication and sent her home. She probably ate something bad, they thought. But this wasn't the case. Her headache continued and continued. She went to the hospital again, but she didn't get a proper diagnosis. She was tested for viruses or bacteria, and nothing. She was tested for autoimmune disorders or cancer, nothing. In the meantime, her headache became unbearable. Her heart was beating rapidly and she couldn't think straight anymore. Then she had a seizure, and another, and another, and she fell into a coma. All stories need a hero, and here is ours today. One doctor knew about teratomas, and he theorized that CT might have one. So he tested the blood and found unusual proteins, which are normally only found in early developments. This verified his theory. When her ovaries were scanned, they indeed found a teratoma. You might now ask, how does a teratoma in the hips explain a headache in the brain? You see, teratoma contain underdeveloped weird tissues. In CT's case, it contained brain tissue. And for a long time, this was an issue. But then for an unknown reason, her immune system started to recognize the brain tissues in her ovaries and attacked it. The immune system started to cause inflammation and made antibodies against the brain tissue. The same antibodies then also traveled through the bloodstream to her head, where they attacked the brain. And this was the ultimate cause for her headache and her seizures later on. Fortunately, CT's teratoma could be surgically removed. There was no metastasis and the attacking antibodies could also be treated through medication. It took her several weeks to recover, but in the end, she could walk home and live her life normally.
Teratomas are something we do not want to encounter in our lice. They look horrific and in some cases can be life-threatening. But teratomas also have been important for science. The teratoma assay has been especially crucial in stem cell biology. In order to make a teratoma, a stem cell has to be capable of making brain cells, muscle cells, and many other types of cells. Not every stem cell can do that. In fact, only pluripotent stem cells found in early development can give rise to so many different cell types. In a teratoma assay, we transplant cells into mice to see if they can make a teratoma. If they can, then we have verified that they are pluripotent stem cells. Okay, but how does this help us? How does an assay which only detects pluripotent stem cells in early development, how is it actually useful for us? Have scientists forgotten what they put into the petri dishes? Well, no. The teratoma assay has been involved in many important studies, including one Nobel Prize study. In 2006, stem cell biology was changed forever in Japan. Shinya Yamanaka and Katsutoshi Takahashi knew that stem cells in their embryo can go on and become all kinds of different cells. They now tried to find out though if we also can go the other way. Can, for example, skin cells transform back into a pluripotent stem cell? In order to answer this question, scientists started to activate embryonic genes in skin cells. Embryonic genes are only active in early development, and they give embryonic stem cells their identity. By activating embryonic genes in skin cells, the scientists try to find out if they can change the identity of a skin cell back into the identity of an embryonic stem cell. For a long time, not much happened. But after activating four different genes at the same time, they saw that the cells started to look different. They didn't look like skin cells anymore, but more like embryonic stem cells. They called these cells induced pluripotent stem cells. In order to prove whether these induced pluripotent stem cells are really pluripotent, they transplanted them into mice. After a while, the induced pluripotent stem cells formed teratoma. Now they knew that they have just created stem cells from skin cells. Teratoma are now a bit out of fashion since they are a bit unstructured and chaotic. But what if we can control the development of embryonic stem cells, which otherwise would make teratoma? Instead of having a mass of different cell types like we have in teratoma, we can try to only create certain tissues or even whole organs in a laboratory. This is what scientists try to do right now. We can cultivate induced pluripotent stem cells in a petri dish, and after a while we add certain molecules which are found in early development. In this way, the stem cells get signals to develop in a controlled fashion and makes parts of the bodies we want. To this date, a lot of different cell types have been grown from induced pluripotent stem cells, and these include brain cells, immune cells, muscle cells, skin cells, and so on. It gets even more interesting though if we try to make whole tissues or organs. Organoids are three-dimensional organ-like structures which are grown in the laboratory. Also here we add and remove certain molecules to stem cells, but this time we control even more parameters to not only make specific cell types but whole tissues. Organoids have been grown to mimic most parts of the body, and they already helped us in the past. In 2015, a mysterious outbreak occurred in Brazil. Thousands of infants were born with a condition called microcephaly. In this case, the brain is underdeveloped and the head is smaller than usual. Scientists tried to find the cause of the disease, and they suspected the Zika virus to be the culprit. So the question now is, how could we test such a theory? We cannot really infect any infants or developing embryos in order to find out if they get microcephaly. So instead, they infected brain organoids with the Zika virus.
Brain organoids mimic the developing brain, and if the Zika virus leads to brain damages, it should also affect brain organoids.
They quickly observed that infected brain organoids cannot grow properly anymore, which proved the theory and helped to contain the outbreak. But of course, this is not the only application of organoids. Kidney organoids, meaning organoids that mimic the kidney, have been used to find out whether drugs are toxic. Tumor organoids, which have been isolated from cancer patients, have been used to find out whether we can identify new cancer drugs. In 2019, for example, lung cancer organoids were used to identify peritinib as an effective treatment against lung cancer. This drug was then used in a clinical phase 1 trial, and it looks promising so far. But scientists even want to go a step further. Scientists want to create transplants in a laboratory. For example, scientists try to grow tissues which contain beta cells to cure diabetes. Others try to grow hearts in order to one day have heart transplants. And some scientists try to grow kidneys or livers in petri dishes. And here teratoma assays will make a comeback. Not by being used as transplants themselves, but by ensuring that none of these organs are able to form teratoma, meaning that we can create potentially safe organs. The question is, how long will it take until we have these technologies, and how far can we even go? But that's something for another day. For now, a question to you.
What's your opinion on growing tissues and organs in a lab? I hope that you liked this video.
If so, leave a comment, and also like this video if you enjoyed it, and do all the other cool YouTube stuff, or don't do it however you feel, and with that, I'll see ya. If you want to know how a baseball accident made a genius, or how we can control games with our minds, you might like these videos.